chrome's out in a Hummer, babe. Hit the park and parlay. Hope that your walk is away. Cause you and your girls wanna ride. Play all day, puff on the line. Ooh, say what, say what, say what. You know that I like it, baby. Ooh, what's up? And you know what I need.
Say what, say what, say what.
You know that about it, baby.
Ooh,
girl, you know what's up.
You know what's up.
Big you. I'm big
you. You know what's up.
I know what's up.
Said I'm big you.
And I'm wanting you.
Tell me what's so up.
Tell me what's up, baby. People thighs and I'm zoned. Dress on. I think I feel a bone coming on. Girl, you got me wide open. Waiting all day and I'm hoping. So baby, don't front. Backseat deep, you know what I want.
Say what, say what, say what.
You know that I like it, baby.
Girl, you know what's up.
And you know what I need.
Say what, say what, say what.
You know that I'm about it, baby.
Girl, you know what's up.
Can we ascend to higher heights and when the path gets rough? We can get into brighter nights, breathe with peace. It's found by leaps and soul to reap our souls to keep. The passion's deep and filled with heat. Living this life on the hustle, I barely get enough time. You know me from the platinum, how I stack them and shine. You see a lot of contenders, they try to end up in my world. A reputation known as the untouchable girl. I'm moving on and now I'm trying to make a change in my ways. Be the best that I can be to last me all of my days. Now we can blaze pathways or just take our time. Better holler if you hear me, cause left eye gon' shine. My eyes don't lie, see how they glisten when you pass me by. You and I don't need permission to be unified. Surely I done seen and heard of many places. Then I traveled around the world, see many faces. Don't let another one get near me if you wanna be true. And show me that nobody else can do it better than you. So if you're serious, I'm curious to see what you got. My love is furious cause I believe in blowing up spots.
All right, what's up? What's going on, guys? Another day in paradise. Shout out to you. What's up? What's up? And of course, we got Val in the house. Shout out to you, Val. So, guys, this is like a continuation or part two to yesterday's stream. Yesterday, I went over the video, a discussion by Panama Jackson. Now, he wrote an article. Now, the video that I reviewed yesterday, they based their interview or their discussion based off this article that came out prior before the discussion. So I kind of did things in reverse, but I just wanted to cover that video firstly because I thought it was worthy to. So I'm going to share my screen right now and I'm going to get right to it. And we got this article. You guys can see that for sure. Now, this was published December 5th, 2017. So it was quite some time ago. That's like, what, 7 years ago, about that? By Panama Jackson. Remember, Panama Jackson, mulatto, okay? Same configuration as me. Has a white mother, black father. But of course, as we've demonstrated and have noted, there is a generational nuance when we analyze these different age demographics and generations revolving this discussion of biraciality or mulatto-ness per se. There is in fact nuances when we look at the different generations and their value systems where they tend to lean towards and their just general outlook on things. So I definitely ruffle feathers for sure. Definitely just a millennial cat that's sharing my perspective out there. And I appreciate you guys here tuning in, joining me for this ride. So I named the stream here, "My mom is white, but I'm not." Now, I mean, of course, that can apply to me. I'm mulatto. My mom's white. My dad's black. I'm part of both of my parents, but I'm basically a new entity, an independent entity. Okay. So we can go over, you know, obviously the definition of what is a mulatto. Mulatto is a person that has one black parent and one white parent, or a person that has two mulatto parents, right? Very simple to understand. So the title here for Panama Jackson, the article he wrote, now his title is, "My mother is white, I am not. I'm being biracial without identity issues." Now, this identity issues component, I don't really see that being pushed by white society. When I analyze their literature, their commentary all over social media, the ones that they publicize, you know, because there's a lot of discussions they have that are kind of sequestered. They don't want the public to see. But when I look at like the Twitter sphere and all this stuff, and, you know, white people, mostly the men, putting in their kind of viewpoints, I don't really see the whole identity component being addressed. One of their major grievances is that most of these mulattoes, most in America, they're half white, they got a white parent, they typically lean towards the black side and they cape hard as fuck for blacks. A lot of these mulattoes, they cape harder for blacks than even blacks themselves. And it has a lot of the white Americans scratching their head, asking the question, why? Why do you cape for people who spit in your face and mock you? Okay. And so when I think of this identity issues thing, who are the people who are pointing the finger at you and telling you who had identity issues? I just uploaded a short video the other day, I think yesterday. And it was literally, let me play that actually to get into this article, because I'm saying this is all congruent. Like, who are the main ones when I analyze social media telling y'all, all you people, my audience, you got identity issues? You're not black identified. You're not kissing my black ass. So I'm just going to mock you and say, you got identity issues, right? Let me play this for you guys. Okay. Let me share my screen. Just find this kind of hilarious, because this whole identity component, I identify as mulatto, which is normal. That is my configuration. So I just uploaded this yesterday, and these were some comments that I saw on TikTok. Now, it was a biracial lady who has a biracial page. Shout out to her. And someone put in the comment section, a lot of mixed people need therapy. Right? A lot of, I mean, the nerve and the audacity of the communitas, of the bottom dwellers, the former slaves, to talk about anybody needing, you know, therapy, right? And a person puts here, replying to the comment, they need it bad. You can always tell when they're white mom and a black dad, they are the worst, right? So we know these are basically black female, BWE, you know, dust vester types, okay? You guys see this here? This is what I'm talking about. I collect a lot of these kind of receipts, okay? Another communita quain, another black quain with her racism. She puts here, they need it bad. She's referring to therapy. The pro-whack communita has a lot of anti-biracial racist tropes that they push as far as this identity component, okay? And they target us mainly. They don't look at the LGBT or other groups and mention identity. They use the identity argument as a... That's what I wanted to point out with the communita, the AA communita. They don't really talk about LGBT. You have literally people out here that are black, monoracial black and monoracial white, that go through entire sex changes or they have body dysmorphia. You have literally people out here who are monoracial who want to kind of, you know, LARP and cosplay as a whole nother identity. We have all these, you know, black Americans who say, I'm really an indigenous aboriginal American. I'm not black. I'm coppered colored. You have these people here who will say they're actually a Moor. They're not a black American. But it's like, I'm seeing this stuff, but then it's like this whole identity thing. There's nobody that's more mentally fucked and confused as far as identity than your detractors, the biracial detractors, right? They'll even, I did a video, they'll even say you're bipolar. They'll say biracial, bipolar. They'll kind of equate it as being synonymous. But this is an attack. This is a racial attack on you that we see that the blacks are doing, okay, to biracials. So, of course, I'm here. My social media is designated to rebuttal them. And what you'll find is your main opposition is these black identified biracials. That is literally your main opposition for an individual like me.
A weapon as an attack on biracial people. So she's saying that we need therapy bad. She puts here, you can always tell when the white mom and the black dad, they are the worst. So this is another anti-biracial, anti.
Right. Just wanted to share that to lay the pretense that I literally saw a comment like that the other day. The other day, I saw it on TikTok and I shared it and I was like, oh, okay, interesting. Yeah. Because these people are showing their ass. And I'm a millennial guy, but we're going to get into this article. This, you know, Panama Jackson is probably an Xer, typical. A lot of these Xers are kissing black ass. And so they see a guy like me, you bet your bottom dollar they're going to have an issue. They see a guy like me. So let's get into this. My mother is white and I am not. I'm being biracial without identity issues. Because remember, Panama Jackson is biracial, but he doesn't have identity issues because he chooses to identify as black, right? If you choose to identify as biracial or not black, all of a sudden, you know, you have identity issues. That's what your opposition is going to basically suggest, okay? Editor's note, this piece speaks for the perspective of being biracial with black and white parents. Okay, mulatto. Yeah, make it simple for you. I realize that other biracial ethnic mixes may or may not share any of these experiences. Right. Of course. That's why the specificity is necessary. A few weeks ago, I wrote a piece called Black Folks Who, though invited, probably wouldn't come to the cookout. They wouldn't come to the cookout. Okay. That's in the whole, like I said, guys, the whole black card and cookout, you know, analogies, those are based on this membership access component, being welcomed into the group or welcomed into the tribe. This is what they refer to, the membership access. Because their literally protocol is so lenient, they let anybody, I mean, you're dealing with people who sold their own to be slaves. So they really have no, you know, social structure. Or, you know, they don't gatekeep to the extent of other groups. Okay. So that's why they basically invite everybody to the cookout. And the only people they're going to gatekeep are biracials because they need their subordinate class to stay loyal, right? So this cookout analogy. On this list, I included the following people: Mariah Carey, Meghan Markle, Rashida Jones, Lenny Kravitz, all mulattoes. Would they come? We many never know. Be sure is shooting. An early comment on Facebook pointed out solely that Mariah Carey is biracial. I believe Meghan Markle is biracial as well. Yeah, they're all mulattoes. Okay. Cool. Well, I can't speak for the commentator. My assumption is that he believed that their biracialness excludes them from a list with a leap of quote unquote black folks. Though I'm surprised he didn't realize that Rashida and Lenny are also biracial in a way that Sean Fury can appreciate. Put a pin in this. Don't know who Sean Fury is. Last week, the world was abuzz with the news that Prince Harry and Meghan Markle became engaged. As these things typically go, the black community was afluttered with the unicorn sightings and fairy dust and all the other components of black girl magic up in here. And sure as more shooting, it didn't take long before quote unquote the other half, pun intended, pointed out that Markle was not in fact black, but biracial. This led to a piece right here by Damon Young titled, "Everything You Need to Know About Meghan Markle's quote unquote level of blackness explained," in which he included the following. There's also been conversation about whether Meghan Markle even deserves this title of specifically black ass attention because she might not identify as black. I don't either. So yeah, stick that in your juice box and suck it. Basically, she's not black enough to get any love from black people. I mean, yeah, you're dealing with people who have a lot of trauma, right? A lot of trauma, and there's a lot of it. People can make up a lot of historical, not make up, but they can point to a lot of historical kind of reasons why. But you're dealing with people who are very, you know, damaged and traumatized. So a lot of them, they hate themselves. And unfortunately, they project it onto themselves and other people who are adjacent to them, meaning multiracials or biracials. My whole thing is I'm trying to tell these mulattoes, look, you just got to get the hell away from them. If they're not going to benefit you in any way, don't cape. Okay. Don't cape. Unless they're paying you. Okay. Yeah, I know. And that's fucking dumb. Meghan Markle was born black and is going to DIE black. Well, she's actually biracial and she identifies as biracial. Her mother is black. A lot of people will say her mother's mixed. I don't know. She looks black to me. She could be a grift. I'm not going to get too specific. The point is that she identifies as biracial. And we know her father is a Caucasian man. Okay. So, but this guy, I already did the video yesterday with the discussion that he had with another mulatto with the Black Power media. It's always these mulattoes caping the hardest for blacks. Okay. And this guy who wrote this article, the words I'm reading to you right now, he publicly said in that video that I reviewed yesterday that he loves a one drop rule, that he supports the one drop rule. He sponsors it, endorses it. These people are not your friend. I mean, if you are a biracial person, you want to have your own space, your own, you know, situation going on. You have these type of biracials who literally want to promote the one drop rule, the weaponizing against you to neutralize you, to go back and serve blacks, to be a subordinate. And there's many other people who do that as well, who, you know, basically have, you know, their bastard kids by black men. They have other methods, what they're doing as well, but they still want you to go back and be a subordinate to black people, okay? Her mom is from frickin' Crenshaw, California, for Christ's sake. Like, that's supposed to be your black card, from frickin' Crenshaw. And this was in 2017. I mean, 50% of Compton, California, in Los Angeles is like Latino Chicano. A lot of the blacks are moving out of California, Southern California. They're going elsewhere. So I don't know that hood credential because she's from a neighborhood. But that's the type of level of people you're dealing with, you know, because you have people who try to kind of posture that on me. Well, I'm from the hood, man. You from the, I'm from the hood. You from the suburbs. I'm like, look, stay your ass over there in the hood with the rest of the hood boogers. Go keep your ass over there. Don't come over here. Okay. With that weak shit. So I love how they try to act like it's a flex. It's only a flex with the bottom dwellers. I'm from the hood. I'm from the hood. I don't care where you're from. Okay. And yeah, but they use that as kind of a G pass, a hall pass, right? If your mom is from the exact same place where, quote unquote, I hate the back of Forrest Whitaker's neck. Interesting, was said. Any offspring she has will be blacker than a bottle of S-curl activator. It's science. It's not science. And he doesn't specify any science, no scientific. This is not a science guy, as far as I'm concerned. This is purely conjecture from what I'm reading at this point. Meghan Markle is a biracial woman. She proudly identifies, but of course your one droppers are going to try to, because she's in the spotlight. She's in the social media spotlight all over the place, and she's in prestige, married into the royal family. So, you know, these black supremacists, these pro-blacks, they're going to really try to attack her. If she was a random woman working at Starbucks and she had a white partner, none of these pro-wacks would say a thing about her. They always want to attack and weaponize the one-drop rule against the mulattoes who have prestige in society, who have fame and notoriety. Those are the ones they want to use, and they want to live vicariously through them. And they want to get them to use their palatability, use their quote-unquote proximity to whiteness to try to uplift these blacks, these darker-skinned Bantus, so they can get closer and more comfortable to their white massa. So they want to use the mulattoes to do that. So that's why they really go after Meghan Markle, is what I'm seeing. But no, it doesn't matter. Meghan Markle has a black mom. Okay, she has a white father. Therefore, she's biracial, not black. Continuing on. But what if Meghan Markle rejects her blackness? Well, what we see with a lot of these biracials is they reject their whiteness. You know, it's never really, the question is never really asked. Why do they reject their white side when they're, a lot of the times their white side fed them, clothed, bathed, housed them, gave them an education, provided so much for them? Like, why is it that they reject that? It's very common. It's almost like it's socially acceptable. But all of a sudden, if they reject their black side, maybe their black side done them dirty. Maybe their black side abandoned them, which is very common with a lot of biracials in America, especially if you have a black father. We come to find out a lot of times their black daddy abandoned them, like Barack Obama. Sage Steele pointed that out. Sage Steele, her black father, didn't abandon her. She's proudly identified as biracial, but she pointed out Barack Obama's black identified, but his black father abandoned him. It's like, come on, why is this politically, socially acceptable for these biracials to basically kind of reject their European heritage and only uplift blackness? Just like Colin Kaepernick, who's one of the biggest ungrateful brats we see. Black parents nowhere to be found, adopted by white people, yet he wants to throw white people, his white adopted family, under the bus to make a buck. Okay. More than a buck, he's going to make millions off that. But yeah, this is the root, by the way, guys. I think I don't know if I gave a disclaimer. This is the root. The root we know is liberal, pro-whack, pro-LGBT. So, you know, she hasn't done that. But even if she had, well, that ain't her choice to make. Her saying, quote unquote, yeah, I'm not black, would be like me saying, yeah, I'm going to be 6 feet, 7 inches from now on. People who know me would say, Damon, I'm sorry, but you're 6 feet, 2 inches now, and you haven't grown since you were 19. Stilts might help, maybe. And people who hate me would still say, I hate your 6 foot, 2 rear end. F you. In your 74 inches, yeah, whatever. Did I call myself 67? He's trying to equate the fact that of this foolishness of height and these racial question, is racial configuration, which is completely bogus, fugazi. So the world sees her as a black woman. The world sees her as a mixed woman, especially the black world. Okay, all the pro-blacks. But the thing is, see, they weaponize the one-drop rule against mulattoes. I've already stated a minute ago to do their bidding for them because they want acceptance from white society. And they know the mulattoes are more palatable because we're literally half or more than half, 60% in the case of Markle, even other people, Derek Jeter, whatever, are, you know, 60%, you know, plus they're more European. So they're more palatable. A lot of white people can see themselves in the mulatto. Like take a Vin Diesel, for example. Okay. That's why he gets a lot of movie roles. Very palatable to the audience. And same thing with Meghan Markle. So yeah, the world doesn't see her as a black woman. And this guy doesn't speak for the world. He doesn't know the world. This is a liberal shill on the root with his article that's being promoted on the root, which they have a lot of traffic. They have a lot of liberal fucktards who watch or read their material. So I'm sitting here thinking to myself like, no, I mean, and like I said, mostly black people will say she's biracial. Meghan Markle clearly looks like the aesthetic of a mulatto woman. Clearly a biracial woman. So don't let these old antiquated, you know, pro-whack Gen Xers try to fool you. The world doesn't see her as black. Anywhere in Africa Meghan Markle goes, everybody's gonna say, you white woman, right? She's the seed of her white father, right? She can go in South America, you know, and even in Europe, people are not, they're gonna say, oh, you Italian, you're a Greek or something, you're a Southern European. This is, Meghan Markle is the furthest thing from a black woman. Her mother's black, yes, not her. Continuing on, the hate mail and racist tweets directed toward her are because of said blackness. You know, and the thing is with that, it says, not her character arc with Mike Rose. The thing is, there's people who have said racist things to me that would be directed toward. Yeah, they'll see the blackness in you and they'll attack it. But you bet your bottom dollar when they see a guy like me standing next to some dark skinned Bantu like Wesley Snipes, you know damn well who they're going to point the finger at and say, that's the black there. They're not going to point the finger at me. Or like a Tom Morello. You guys know Tom Morello. Or Tinashe. Or Tyla. Okay, these actresses, these actors and actresses and musicians or whatever, these kind of visible mulattoes in media, Kamala Harris, whatever. No, they're going to look at the dark-skinned Bantu, the Haitian, like the White House press secretary, you know, Karine St. Pierre, whatever her name is. I know she's Haitian, LGBT, and she's black, okay? They're looking at her, that's a black, not a person like me or Meghan Markle. But they'll see the blackness. Yeah, they'll attack you. Okay, that's fine. There's visibility there. But like when we're in a room with them, it's like there's a clear distinction, a clear difference. We're exploring that now. And we are basically promoting that difference. Okay, if I can say that. Not our character. Yeah. Okay. Remember, this guy's a proud one dropper. He loves a one drop rule, right? What Damon is speaking to is the historical one-drop rule. And this guy already, I told you guys yesterday, I reviewed the video. I'm going to eventually clip it, what I did yesterday, to let this guy know. These younger people, they're questioning this foolishness. He loves the one-drop rule, a racist. Like, you'll find a lot of Afrocentrics, a lot of pro-wacks who talk about slavery and the civil rights. They love the one-drop rule because they want to use mulattoes for their political agenda. They know their numbers numerically are dwindling. They're losing numbers in America. They see all the mass immigration that are not from black nations, from Nigeria and Haiti, some other countries, but mostly from India, South America, Central America, like Mexico. So their numbers are basically being, you know, flooded by these other groups who are not black and they're not black identified. So now they really want to promote this one drop rule to get all these mulattoes and multiracials underneath their, you know, failing, you know, political agenda. It's failing. Okay. And they have nothing to offer. They have no businesses or nothing to offer. So it's just laughable at this point. So yeah, you'll find that your Afrocentrics, they really love that one drop rule, right? The slave era relic. That requires, it wasn't even slave era. That's the thing. The one drop rule was established post-slavery in the 1924 Racial Integrity Act. And it, you know, 1924, and then they removed Mulatto from the census, 1930. And then Loving in Virginia was what, 1967? It was literally only a few decades. We can just say, just to be safe, four decades, 40 years. They try to act like it's all ancient and, you know, no, literally in the 1790 census, they had mulatto on the books. Mulatto has always been an independent category. This is prior to America. We've had the mulatto designation all the way in the Iberian Peninsula. Mulatto is a Spanish word. So, of course, Spain, Portugal, etc. comes from mulawad, which is an Arabic term, which means mixed. So prior to even this, the inception of this nation of the United States of America, we have had a unique designation for people who are biracial, mulatto, right? So yeah, it's not a slave era relic, okay? It's, we can say, century old, 100 years ago. We're in 2024, yeah. So 100 years ago, 1924, the Racial Integrity Act in Virginia, they did establish the one-drop rule. Well, we see now these pro-blacks, these Afrocentrics, they are weaponizing the one-drop rule against mulattoes to fulfill their political agenda because they need foot soldiers. They want to use mulattoes. They want to use the fact that mulattoes have proximity to whiteness and white capital and white resources. They want to use us, mulattoes, because of our palatability. They want to use us and weaponize us to kind of bring, to make the dark-skinned Bantus, bring them closer to their white massa. Because all they want is white acceptance. When you deal with these Bantus, these dark-skins, they just want white acceptance. They don't want justice or fairness or equality. They want their white massa to pat them on the back and say, good job, boy. That's what they want. But they want to use us to get them to that position. Okay. This is why they weaponize the one-drop rule. requires anybody with even a drop of black blood to identify as black, or at the very least, not white, to make sure that pure white folks could maintain their power, probably once they realize that after, you know, forced essay and torturing black B-dubs, they were not creating new white people, but new mixed people. I got to correct the guy, not blacks. They weren't creating blacks. A black person is, you know, you're the seed of your father. You have a white father, black mother, you're biracial, not black. You have a black father, white mother, you're biracial, not black. Okay, put a pin on this. I'm not going to put a pin on anything. This is complete hogwash and garbage. I'm dissecting this and analyzing this for my audience because they're smart enough. I have enough faith in my audience and integrity. I've done a pretty good job to curate the people that I'd like to see over here in the chat. Let them know that this is serious stuff. You have to analyze these articles. You have to question your academics, the political establishment, your overclass. Question these people. Okay, question me for sure. Do it in a respectful way, you know, but if the trolling stuff, it's just, you know, it's futile, honestly. But that kind of comes with the whole territory. When you're making traction, you're doing something substantial, you're going to get trolled and hated on, right? People are going to use you for clout. So remember this guy, he's a Afrocentric pro-black one dropper. He loves a one drop rule. And if sad part is that he has a white mom, he's half white himself, mulatto guy. But we often find this out, that a lot of these mulattoes, like, they hate themselves and they just want to serve blacks. That's their kind of lot in life they choose. I read the op-ed that Markle wrote for Ellie, in which she spoke about how she identifies herself. It's an interesting read, or as interesting as one of those pieces where a racially ambiguous person attempts to explain how they deal with their racial ambiguousness can be. Her conclusion, instead of living in the gray, proverbial gray, or both being black and white, she chooses to create her own box of self-identity. Good for her. I respect that. That's what we're doing over here. We realize with the Office of Budget and Management, the federal government, they're going to recognize and honor all these other ethnic groups that are coming into the country, United States, I'm speaking about. But when it comes to us historically, they want to deny us of our representation, which is literally unconstitutional. They want to tell us, oh, well, you got to, you know, you're partially black, so you got to check black and help the blacks. No. I'm just one guy, one millennial guy with the internet connection, the microphone. It's going to move forward into the future. I'm telling you, this younger generation, these Zs and after them, they're not having it. They're not going to serve blacks like these Xers, the article I'm reading right now. Okay. We realize today now we have other options and we are exploring those options. If I didn't define myself for myself, I'd be crunched into other people's fantasies and eaten alive. And he got the fro with the clenched fist. Yeah. He joined the team and you're literally being eaten alive in that group. You're being absorbed. I don't know who this guy is, Andre Lord. Maybe I can do a little quick search and see. American writer and professor. I don't know who he is. But yeah, whatever. Getting back into this, self-identity is defined as the recognition of one's potential and qualities as an individual, especially in relation to social context. Self-identity. Here's where I point out some facts about myself. I am mixed. I'm the product of a white woman from France. This is, Panama Jackson speaking now. His mom is white from France, and his father is a black man from Alabama. I tell you without hesitation that I'm biracial. Okay, yeah. But you love the one-drop rule, which is kind of a contradiction, right? Well, I will also tell you without hesitation and with pride is that I am black. It's kind of a contradiction. They do have this term out there. They call it a black biracial. It's where they have to be honest with themselves and genetically and biologically say, look, yeah, I'm biracial. I came out of the womb of a white vagina. You have it, because I find that typically most biracials in America have white moms, black dads. When I'm talking about mulatto biracials, okay, let me be specific. I'm not talking about Hoppa or Blaxican or other kind of configurations. I'm talking about specifically black white biracials. Most of us have in America have white moms, black dads. So you'll have these people like this guy here, Panama Jackson. they'll use a political term. It's kind of like their pronoun. They'll say they're a black biracial, meaning they identify as black, but they acknowledge that they're biracial. Okay. And of course, this is going to be your main opposition. Those of you who are mulatto, who are proud to be mulatto, etc., your main opposition is going to be these individuals. Okay. Would also tell you, yeah, as I'm black, I identify as black. I was raised that way. I was raised in a household by my black father and black stepmother and my black sisters. My upbringing was full of blackness, not even intentionally, but by virtue of who my parents are. My white mother obviously had a hand in raising me. We spent summers with her in Michigan, but largely my foundation, self-esteem, pride, and identity were crafted by my black parents. Because I believe his black father remarried, so he had like a black stepmom. And that's the thing I've mentioned yesterday in my stream, is that identity is the main component. It's not your kind of parentage configuration, as others might claim. It's more so going to be your environment. Your environment is going to be the main indicator of this identity component. And also by society, I grew up overseas, and while we were mostly Americans to our German host, the word nigger isn't just an American term. The difference between being black and white was made clear from an early age, and my father made sure to prepare me for that. Be who you are. Just don't forget who they see. Trying to instill fear in his eyes. And he looks more so, I guess you can say, Negroid type of characteristics, phenotype. I already shared with him yesterday. Okay, he's on the thumbnail as well. The thumbnail of this stream is the guy who wrote this article, Panama Jackson. So, you know, I guess the only comparisons with me and him is maybe the skin tone complexion. He might be a little darker. I don't know, but we're both bald. You can take that, you know. But a lot of people don't know. I have more, a lot of ambiguity. People don't know what the hell I am. People say I'm like Puerto Rican or something. You know, what are you, Puerto Rican or something? Rude awakenings are not my ministry. While my self-identity wasn't shaped to protect me from the big, bad world, it did instill in me a sense of pride in who I was. I am mixed, but I'm black. I'm mixed, but I'm black. And I learned lessons from that vantage point. That's how I grew up. Let me also say that I never in my entire life had anybody tell me I wasn't black enough or that I wasn't white enough. Now that, like I said, is a key component. Because when you're somebody, like I take for me, my personal experience example, you know, you'll go into spaces and you'll realize, oh shit, these people are jealous of you. And if because they're jealous of you, they feel like you have something they want, then they're going to attack you for that. They're, and their main weapon besides savagery to try to like physically harm you is to outgroup you. Okay. I'm not the only one. I got a lot of my audience members, a lot of listeners, supporters who can attest to that and share similar examples and stories of how this works. So for him, for this guy who wrote the article, his experience is different, and a generation and environment plays a critical factor in that. But for me, it was a lot different. Like, you know, especially when I became an adult, I didn't really see these issues until, like I say, a decade ago. Like I said, around 2015. And as an adult, working adult, and then just traveling this country, going into different environments, different spaces, I was like, okay, there's a lot of these people that are fucked up, that got a lot of trauma, and they're trying to project that trauma into me, and I'm not having it, okay? But yeah, the whole black card thing, yeah, that'll definitely, yeah. And as far as the white enough thing, yeah, you know, that's something you have to deal with. What's the solution here? The solution isn't just to kiss black ass and prove your blackness. The solution is to create something that uniquely serves you. Give people a voice who feel like they don't have a voice. This is hence what I've done with all my social media, okay? I don't know if that's because of the energy I put out, my surroundings, or because I'm a man. Maybe it's all three. But I think it's worth mentioning that I've never dealt with the stereotypical mixed kid struggle. Fitting in is what you talk about, right? Mixed kid struggle, fitting in. And I just gave you the solution to create your own. Okay. And a lot of these younger cats, like I've seen some students, you know, at one of the elementary schools I was working at, and I see the students and I'm looking at them and, you know, talking, interacting with some of them. It's like, look, they're just going to eventually figure it out. They're going to go through some scenarios where they're going to figure it out eventually. So I'm not going to pressure or push or, you know, anybody. I'm going to treat everybody with respect, treat everybody as an equal member of society, of humanity. You know, but like I say, I look at some of the younger mulattoes, like they're just going to figure it out on their own. Like, you know, the blacks are going to push them out, outgroup them. The whites are going to do a similar thing. They're going to come to the conclusion that, oh, shit, people are extremely tribalistic out here in this competitive society, and they are going to need to find their tribe. Okay, they're going to need to find their tribe, and they will eventually. It's only going to grow. So, but I'm just one voice amongst many. My job here is to help give people a voice. So, of course, it says, of course, I've been on the receiving end of light skin jokes. Yeah, and then make a dark skin joke and watch them cry. Watch them call you a white supremacist. Watch, you know, make a dark skin joke. You know how sensitive those people are. You make a dark skin joke, they're all going to whine and cry for the next 400 years. But of course, they make a light skin joke. Oh, no biggie. Just laugh with them. Brush it off. You guys are fucking punks. A lot of you biracials are fucking punks. And when appropriate, my friends all point out which half of me is being responsible for certain actions. Yeah. My punctuality. Yeah. That's that white side. Yeah. 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 Which half of you, which side of you is upset or this or that? My love for brown liquor. That's the black side. But who am I? Is I never been called into question? While I acknowledge both my mother and that I'm mixed, for me, the choice of how I identify myself is very easy. I love being black and I've always have. It's part of my identity on purpose and with intention, because being black is beautiful to me, for me. And what I had to realize, especially when I got to college, is that not every mixed person feels this way or views it through such a simple and queer lens. You're damn right. A lot of us don't. It's not cut and dry like that. Okay. Some of my earliest arguments in college came from discussions with other mixed individuals who felt like I was denying who I am by claiming to be black. I wasn't being true to myself by choosing only one half of my genetic makeup to claim. Acknowledging being mixed but claiming to be black was a slap in the face of my mother and my true heritage, a mixed one. Okay. Mulatto-ness. Okay. Embrace it. Talking to these younger cats, younger folks, learn to embrace it, because we're not going anywhere. Our numbers are growing. I had some variation of that debate every year of college and even some post-college. What I found most telling about those discussions is that I had to defend my blackness to other mixed students at HBCUs. HBCUs were literally founded for guys like him, for these mulattoes, the mulatto offspring of the white plantation class, okay, in the south of the United States. That's where pretty much all your HBCUs are at. You have one in Los Angeles, which is named after a mulatto, Charles Drew. It's like a medical school, pretty small school, but it's still under the HBCU umbrella. I went to Morehouse College, and I was having discussions with other people from Morehouse and Spelman College. Spelman, named after a white man. I believe he was like a Catholic priest, if I'm not mistaken. Just like Howard University. It's a big HBCU. Howard is named after a white Union soldier. I'm not sure about Morehouse. Haven't looked up the title, the school. I know it's a biggity-biggity-blackity-black school, though I do know that. Who were trying to get me to claim and at least partially my whiteness while basking in and benefiting from black surroundings. I don't know if that pushed me further into my black identity or not. They pressured you. Yeah, they pushed you. We could say pressured. Gotta, you know, analyze the semantics here, right? But I never wavered. How could I not be proud to be black, especially given our location? And why would anybody tell me I had to check the quote unquote other or biracial or black and white box on forms? For why? My reality, my truth, and how I was raised were clear. Acknowledge your mother, but don't forget who you are. Yeah, you're biracial. Yeah. Acknowledge your mother. But because we already know, even like halfway, I think, through this article, we already know, we've already read enough, guys, to know he spent a lot of time being raised in a black environment with his black father. Environment is the main indicator, okay, of how the identity component. So his white mom was there in his upbringing, but it's just his black father was more influential. And of course, his black father remarried. So he had a black stepmother and he had black siblings in that environment. So it's funny how it's like, well, I acknowledge your mother, but don't forget who you are. You're biracial. Yeah, acknowledge your mother. He's noticed that he puts that here. He doesn't put acknowledge your mother and acknowledge your father, but know who you are, because he's black identified, guys. So he downplays his white mom. Okay. If it wasn't for his mom, he wouldn't be here. He was literally conceived from the womb of his European mother, who is French, right? Downplaying it, but it's because the environment. Okay. And let's continue on. I realize that for many other people, it's not that simple. I can entirely understand the desire to give credit and respect to both halves of your makeup. That's fair and responsible. I also get how anybody would hate for others to dictate who they are, especially people who don't share in your struggle, as it were. I'm sure Damon's piece, while an opinion, annoyed some mixed people. Who is those non-mixed persons to tell me who I am and how I have to identify? Why do others or society get to determine who I am? And why don't I get to define myself for myself? They do, though, today. They do, though. When they ask you the question, what are you? They're letting you know, they're telling you, you can literally identify yourself. The first time I've done this, I told you guys, I was in a jiu-jitsu class. This was like my first time going to like this specific dojo. This was in Anaheim. And I was trying to test out different dojos. I was already, you know, acquainted with a gym. I was already a member of a gym doing jiu-jitsu. But I wanted to explore and check out other schools to see if they have some good techniques or good training partners, right? And I went to this one gym and I saw on the wall, I saw a flag that was El Salvadorian, which I already can identify that flag. And I saw a Syrian flag. And I pointed to the wall and I was like, oh, I know that flag. It's El Salvadorian. What about that flag? And the guy, the sensei, the teacher, he said, oh, that's part of my heritage. He's like, oh, yeah, I'm half Syrian. I'm half El Salvadorian. I was like, oh, interesting. And then he asked me, what am I? What are you? And I told him I'm, you know, white and black. I'm biracial, or I'm mulatto. I told him I'm mulatto. This was like back in what, 2015, 2016. That's when I first publicly like identified myself verbally in that manner. And he knew the word because he's part of Salvadorian, which is Spanish language, right? So we were both biracial, right? But different configurations. And he understood right away, oh, mulatto, okay. What I'm saying is that he asked me, what am I? And I told him. So I was able to define myself in that moment with this, you know, black belt jiu-jitsu instructor, has his own business, his own school, teaching other students, okay? So when people ask you, when you're ambiguous, they're like, well, what are you? You are literally given the microphone to identify yourself properly. Take advantage of that. I tell people, take advantage. Don't let these pro-wax Afrocentrics try to basically pressure you to be a foot soldier, a mule for their agenda. When people ask you, what are you? Let them know, I'm mulatto. This is how I identify, okay? I honor my heritage on all sides. If Markle isn't choosing one over the other, why does anybody else get to do that for her? If she's setting her own identity, why does anybody else get to chime in on what that is? More important, why did the relics of slavery get to impact who anybody is in 2017? The short answer is because they do. The truth is, and this is difficult for a lot of mixed people to hear, that society does affect who you are. And it also, it's black society, because this guy was raised around blacks. So he identifies with them and their struggle, and he'll take the little light skin jokes. But a lot of us who weren't raised around blacks, we didn't accept their pathology in the kind of subordinate position. We look at black society, and you're right, it does affect us. We're like, hey, they've outgrouped us. They said we're not a part of their tribe. We're not part of their people. We've acknowledged that. Those of us mulattoes were like, okay, we're not fully white. We're not fully black. Let's embrace what we are truly and move forward with that. Okay. So yeah, he's absolutely right. Society does, he capitalizes, does affect who we are. You're right. And like I said, a lot of us got a bad taste from the communita. And then we realize, okay, yeah, these aren't our people. They're not our tribe. We got to do something else. Here we are today. It does help to shape our worldview. You don't have to identify as Black if you don't want to. I don't, okay? But don't pretend that when other people see you, their eyes are deceiving them. See, like the scare tactics, like they want to kind of try to, that's all they have, their strategy though, to force you to be like, look, the one drop rule, everybody sees you as a Black. Like I'm looking, like if I walk in a room and you see some dark skinned Bantu, anybody darker than me, more Negroid features, Wesley Snipes, whatever, they're like, no, that's the Black right there. And this guy, the Mulatto Vanguard, is a mixed guy. He clearly looks like a mixed guy. So, you know, this guy's not fooling anybody, okay? Which is also where I think a lot of mixed folks get into trouble. They don't get into any trouble. The trouble that mixed people get into is when they cape for Blacks and then they're outgrouped by the same people who they cape for. They're spit on and mocked. And then they have to start from scratch asking questions. Okay, why the hell did I waste all that time? That's when they're in trouble, right? It's always off-putting when somebody makes sure to point out that they are not Black, but mixed. Okay, I do that every opportunity I get. So wait a second, I'm not Black. I'm not like them. I'm actually mixed. Yeah, yeah. That's my responsibility. I have to stand up for myself, okay? In a conversation, if you make it a point to dissociate yourself from Blackness, it comes across as condescending, as if being Black is an issue or a problem. And this would likely be the same whether talking to Black or white people. Black people don't want to hear that I'm not Black shit. And I'm guessing white people don't want to hear that I'm half white shit. You can be who you want, but it's important to remember that nobody cares until you start splicing and dicing situationally. Yeah, whatever, dude. We already know, guys, this guy's Black identified. Political, his whole political orientation is serving Blacks, being their magical mulatto. He's a virtue signaler. He's a magical mulatto, trying to make sure all the Blacks are good. That's how he gets his points. That's how he feels good about himself. His purpose in life is to be the special magical mulatto that the Blacks love and praise, like an Obama type. And they all go through academia, okay? Through the liberal ranks, okay, within academia. Defining yourself is very important for many reasons, but race isn't easy. It's been a defining issue for a duration of our existence as a nation. To think that our nation is going to be enlightened about the plight of mixed children is a fool's errand. It's up to us. This guy, clearly, this Black-identified biracial is a coward. And I'll publicly say that. It's up to us. It's up to us to basically force ourselves in the society to state our case. Nobody's going to do it for you. Everybody wants to maintain the status quo. And unfortunately, you have these double agents, these people who are saying, I'm biracial, but I identify as Black. Okay, these double agents who literally want to kind of maneuver you back into the Blackistan plantation. Okay, because they don't give a damn about mixed kids. They only care about the mixed kids who identify as Black. Right. So he's basically trying to discourage you, saying the plight of mixed children, it's a fool's errand. You're not going to convince the nation to care about them. And you guys hear this guy right here? This is not an ally. Not to mulattoes. Not an ally. At the same time, again, I entirely get not liking other people trying to tell you or any other mixed person who you are and how you should identify. But that's not going to change either. Not anytime soon. Yeah. Yeah. He's basically a coward. He accepts his position. Okay, being a subordinate, and he's getting paid, you know, the liberal apparatus, they're going to pay him, right? Because keep this in mind, when Black folks point out that somebody is biracial, as was done in the comments on Facebook, it was done to distance them from Blackness. That wasn't pointed out to grant mixed folks the agency over their self-identity. It was to point out that, hey, those mixed folks aren't Black, fam. They don't get to claim Blackness. That's a privilege or struggle, depending on your worldview, that belongs to actual Black folks, not mixed kids. So this guy, like I said, they're proud subordinates. They want to take the back seat. You guys see this? Like, they've been positioned that way. Like, it's very sad and pathetic how you have a lot of these biracial people who accept that position of servitude. They're proudly like, let me take a back seat, fam. The Black folks are speaking and talking. He doesn't have full membership into that group, but he'll try to scare the rest of you like, oh, the world's going to see you as Black. Yeah, no, it isn't. Go take your ass. Go take your biracial behind to Africa. Let's see how Black you really are. Okay. Go anywhere else. Go to South America, Caribbean. Let's see how biggity Black you really are. Okay. Don't let these academic quacks try to fool you, and they're trying to scare you to, they're weaponizing the one drop rule against you. So you only claim black so they can use you for their Afrocentric pro-whack agenda. Remember, yesterday I did a video reaction. This guy who wrote this article publicly said he loves the one drop rule. He loves it. He embraces it. Okay. They have a political agenda and a motive. They want to destabilize mulattoes, neutralize mulattoes. They want to position us to continuously to serve the pro-whack interest. Okay. So these people, these type of black identified biracials, they accept their position as subordinates underneath blackness. Very pathetic. I'd be remiss if I didn't point out here that there's always a bit of irony in black Americans. Insistence on shooting down biracial folks' blackness is inauthentic because of a white parent, considering that the vast majority of black Americans absolutely have white blood from not so distant past. Yeah, well, you know, having like 5 or 10% white blood, having admixture, it's not the same as having a white parent. And honestly, the sad part is a lot of these people, you find out when you talk about this type of like biracial stuff, you'll have, that's one method that your pro-whacks will use to invalidate you, saying, well, all black Americans are mixed and escape block. Having admixture is a world of difference from someone who's actually mixed and has a non-black parent. Not the same thing. They'll try to muddy the waters and blur the lines to try to trick you to make you think that it's like the same thing. Because, you know, 200 years ago on a plantation, some slave, you know, had the white master's kids, had that mulatto kid. And then that mulatto grew up and basically was absorbed by the blacks. So now today you have some black who's got like 10% or less European admixture. They're going to act, and they're blacky, black, black. They're going to act like they're the same as you with the white parent. Fuck out of here. But they'll do that. They'll bring that up to basically invalidate you, right? They're trying to tell you to shut up, sit your ass down, kiss my black butt. You're not special. Never said I was special. I tell people every stream I get up here, I'm not special. I'm just not black. That's you. You're black. You talk about the black stuff. I'm talking about the mulatto stuff, okay? Deal with it. For some in the black community, biracial folks are nothing but walking, talking, tragic figures who spend their lives complaining about fitting in and acceptance. And I'd be lying if I said I don't know some mixed people who still struggle with their identity. That's their struggle, and they are entitled to it. I, like most of us, people who identify as black is what he's talking about. He's talking about that hive mind. Most of us, he's talking about the Afrocentrics. Okay. He doesn't speak for biracial people. He only speaks for the biracial people who are black identified, who wish to be subordinates under blacks and get absorbed by blacks. And he says, like most of us, most of who? Yeah, the Afrocentrics don't know what drives that train for them. For them, who's them? Them are people like me, the mulattoes who are not black identified. So we already know he chose his team. We already established that on the yesterday stream, on the video that I dissected. Okay, he looks at himself as a black team. He made a couple references to a race war. He's like, okay, it's very simple. When the race war happens, I already know what team I'm on. This is the type of logic you're dealing with this individual, Panama Jackson. Okay, so this is what he's, you know, this is what we already know what team he's on, how he's, his worldview. So when he positions himself saying most of us, what drives that train for them? So us and them, the them is me, the mulattoes who don't identify as black, or like Meghan Markle, because this discussion is based off Meghan Markle. The mulattoes who identify as mulatto or biracial, that's the them. The us, his team, are the black identified. Okay. The thing is with us, or with them, people like me, Meghan Markle, we're growing. Our numbers are growing, baby. Once these mulattoes realize they have another option. And I'm telling you, I'm looking at the young, because if they're Xers older, they're already just going to get on their knees, suck off blacks and kiss the Bantu butt. They're already doing that. Okay. They're trying to convince the rest of us to do that. It's not working, because I'm looking at these younger folks that go on TikTok and all this stuff. Look, they realize they have another option out here. Okay. I think my upbringing made it easy for me. But again, my reality seems to be far removed from many others. even when talking with my white mother and discussing her desire for me to partake of things that felt more true to her, like dating white women, I never wavered in explaining how I live and why I live that way, why I'm comfortable with who I am, and how my racial politics affect my life and choices. Of course, mating habits. His racial politics, it affects his mating habits. You think of like Dr. Umar Johnson, the prince of Papa John's Pizza, right? Where he wants every biracial person to date a black, to marry black, basically to be absorbed. Where your mating habits is basically congruent, you know, with your political agenda. I mean, it's kind of interesting because you have a lot of pro-wax who marry non-black, right? Or they the men, the pro-wack men, dark-skinned Bantus, they marry mulattoes, their preference, right? Like Tariq Nasheed and others. So they're a contradiction. They can break the rules because they're special victims. Dark-skinned Bantus are special victims, so they can break the rules and marry non-black, and yet their blackness is never questioned. But the mulatto, they want the mulatto to marry the black, right? To be absorbed. So he's talking to his white mom, talking about racial politics affect my life and choices, meaning choices and selection of mating partners. Whereas he put here his mom wanted him to date a white woman, but he's like, oh no, I got to date a black woman because I'm black identified. So I got to be absorbed into the blacks. I got to be neutralized. I don't want to create a whole nother class of people, mulattoes, because the blacks are going to get scared, right? And this is a mulatto saying this shit, which is typical, okay? Especially with the generation that is above mine. She might not like it, but she was forced to accept it because, well, she had no choice. I also never felt that I was dishonoring my mother or my heritage in any way. Others might feel different. Cool. I'm going to get right back to this, guys. Just going to take a quick... See a bunch of people up in here. You guys, please hit the like button if you guys like this content. I appreciate it. Hit the like button. And I'm definitely going to get to all of your guys' comments, or I'll try to do the best that I can. But just bear with me right here, and I will be right back in a second. Yeah. Let's do this. Guys, we're back up in the house. So I'm gonna get to some of your comments. I'm gonna get back to the article, but I want to keep you guys engaged in the discussion. Appreciate you guys being here. Let's get right into this. Do you consider people's one mulatto parent? I think I answered that. they have categories here being ultra specific. They have griff or quadroon. Now, I've never heard anybody publicly use these terms. It's basically on the internet. Same thing with like a term like MGM. I mean, there's a gentleman who wrote a book about MGMs, so I encourage you guys to check it out. More on that later. But like griff or quadroon. So griff is someone who's 75% African, or like 70% African, 30%, 25% European, right? And you have quadroon, who's 75% or 70% European, and then like 25 or 30%, whatever. The percentages are there. The heritage based off their parentage configuration. Just to answer this guy's question, do you consider people as a one Mulatto parent and one Black parent? That's a griff. That's a term that they've already established centuries ago to call it a griff. Or a white parent is Mulattoes. If they have one Mulatto parent, one white parent, quadroon. That one Mulatto parent, one Black parent, that's a griff. Like a Beyonce Knowles. Beyonce Knowles has a Mulatto mother and a Black father. So she would fall underneath the criteria of a griff. Someone who has considerable admixture. In her case, Beyonce Knowles is like probably 25% if, you know, European. So, yeah, that's it. Mulatto is distinctively independent. It's distinct. It's very specific. If that makes sense. So the issue is, I find out with this discussion, people want to blur the lines, muddy the waters, open the floodgates so they can basically come on in and neutralize us. It's not happening. Not with me up here. There's a lot of other channels who are the quote unquote biracial channels. You come to find out they're like, you know, whatever, ghetto feminist channels, whatever the hell they are. But if you want biracial topics, this is a channel you come to, specifically dealing with mulattoes. Okay. But shout out to the Hoppas, shout out to the Blaxicans and other, you know, configurations. I follow them. I support them for sure. And definitely with all my other platforms and stuff, there's a lady that has a Hoppa page that I share a lot of material with. If I find anything that has to do with Hoppas, I share it with her. I love to do that. And yeah, so this question here from Chris says, I've noticed most of the quote unquote queens throwing shade at mulattoes for having a white mom are often attracted to white men. Yeah, that could be true. Because they look at the biracial women with white moms, they look at them as competition. Okay. And not only that, like I said, because most of the biracial mulattoes in America have in Canada, North America, and even in England have white moms, Black fathers. So we're the majority. So they're attacking most of us because they look at us as competition. They don't, and Val's in the chat. Val has a Black mom, white father. So she's a mulatto of that configuration, like Meghan Markle. But even Val knows the truth. It's like, they don't really care if your mama's Black. Like the fact that you're lighter skinned than them, you have more European features than them, more proximity to whiteness. That's why they don't like you. A lot of us who are over here on this channel, we get that. We're smart enough to realize that. It has nothing to do with your parents or how you were raised. Because you look at a lot of them, they're raised by bastard, you know, baby makers. They're single moms and, you know, a bunch of pro criminals. And you look at the results, it's like, geez, you know. They shouldn't be talking about anybody's parents. And look at them. Look at their results. As you said, it has been showing before, 9 out of 10 of us mulattoes have a Black dad and a white mom. So if they want to keep using that same trope as an attack, but not attack the Black men. Yeah, they attack the white mom, but not the Black men. Because you understand, I've already went over this as well, just reminding you that with Black women in America, for the most part, their culture, they worship and coddle Black men. So they're angry when Black men choose their preference, which is mulatto, over a Black dark-skinned woman. Or if a Black man gets a white woman, okay? Or any other woman who's not Black. So yeah, they're cowards, okay? And the Black women, they're not going to challenge the ones who, I'm saying they're cowards, not all. I'm saying the ones who attack white women. They're cowards because they'll never attack their part, the male counterpart. They'll never attack the black male for who he chooses, right? They will attack a biracial child. They'll attack children. A lot of these savages are cowards. They'll attack the child and the white mom. They'll attack the white mom, right? Even though a lot of these women, if you look at them in the workplace, I see it all the time in the workplace, they are the biggest suck butts and ass kissers to white women. They're massa. But they just get on the internet and talk shit. I thought of that the other day too. I was like, yeah, they talk all this crap on the internet about white women and white women's biracial kids. But we see them in the workplace. They're all suck butt, kissing butt to white women. Just a plantation spectacle, okay? The first time I've seen Meghan Markle, I didn't even realize she was a mulatta. So those who wants to call her black have something wrong. Yeah. Yeah, it's they're only fooling themselves, right? The way you summed it up reminds me of the movie Blood In and Blood Out. Yeah, Dwayne Johnson, The Rock, he identifies as biracial, right? You said you're 60% European, 37% black. How ridiculous would I look to claim black? Yeah, when you're more European than you are African. But that they want the right of refusal. They want to have power over you. So even if you're like 30% or 40% African, they want you to claim that and just say you're black so they can punk you. They want to trick you and hoodwink you to jump into their group where they're the majority so they can punk you. That's literally the goal. They need a subordinate group because they have such low self-esteem. They want to make themselves feel better. I'm not saying all. I'm not an absolutist, but I'm saying the ones who attack biracials, they have such low self-esteem about they feel about themselves. So they want to feel better about themselves. So they want biracials to be in their group so they can punk them and take advantage of them. They use a one-drop rule to claim that blacks come in all shades. It doesn't. Black comes in limited shades, a black, dark black, which what they call blue, black, purple, and then dark brown. Okay. In some cases, lighter brown. But you look at a guy like me, my complexion, which people would say high yellow, which just means like a black, someone who's black identified, or beige or something. That's not a black feature. Okay. It's not a black characteristic. To be fair, Meghan Markle doesn't really have that many Afro features and could pass as white. In some of her pictures, if anything, she could pass as Hispanic. Exactly, Hispanic. Like I'm saying, if Meghan Markle was in Central America, South America, nobody would call her a black woman. Nobody in Africa, any African nation, would say she's a black woman. Let's cut the BS. Okay, these are these African-American, Afrocentric one-droppers like Panama Jackson, Mulatto, with his white mom, kissing black butt. And he I already analyzed with the article. Still got a little bit more to go. He basically said that he's his white mom told him, you could probably date a white woman or this or that. And he's like, no, because his political affiliation or political kind of stance, his political leanings. And I talked to a guy, Alonzo, AJ the moderator, who's an older mulatto guy, kind of very similar, I'm seeing with the positioning of them, where their life mission is to basically serve blacks. I'm looking at them like, okay, what about the younger mulattoes? You know, they're not going to go that route, right? So what about them? You're just going to leave them hanging? Okay, yeah, we got it. We got the message. But you know what? I'm not going to be in that position, though. I'm not going to be that guy. I'm going to give them something they can use, and then they could pass on. That's my purpose, okay? Yep, I used to identify as black, and I figured out about a year or two ago. Yeah, you got tired of them mocking you for being light-skinned, not being black enough, not fitting in. You realize, look, to be pro-black, you got to be a dark-skinned Bantu. They already have a monopoly on blackness as the dark-skinned Bantus. You got to develop your own shit. And I tell that to the MGMs and even the people who are, you know, griff or like light-skinned black. They got to like develop their own lane, you know. Don't latch on to biracials, okay? Don't latch on to these other groups, but you know the blacks, the Bantus, they're going to, you know, they worship and coddle the dark-skinned Bantus. They want to be baby mamas, okay? They want to be single moms. Like, that's the position they have. So if you don't want that, you have to develop your own situation. I don't understand when other mixed people say I'm mixed but black. Yeah, but I'm mixed, but I serve blacks. I'm black identified. So you're white and black. Black, I know, right? It makes no sense. Yeah, they're just as white as they are black. And in many cases, like even Val was saying, genetically in America, with a lot of the admixture from African Americans, they're more so genetically white than they are black. But they identify as black because of the kind of political ramifications here in America, because of the kind of racial binary nature between black and white. Where in the United States, you have groups like Hispanics and even Arabics. Arabs can be classified as white in a lot of cases, where in other countries, it won't be like that. Like in, you know, Europe, in European countries, there's like clear lines, like maybe in Poland or something, where it's like a 97%+ white nation, where if they're Arab, you know, they might have pale skin, but they got black hair and brown eyes, and they kind of like, hey, you're not white. You're not like us. You're an Arab, right? So the lines are more kind of are less blurred. They're more strict in some parts in Europe. But in America, they redefine the definition of whiteness. Even today, like I'm saying, like I'm looking at some of these quadroons, like a Logic, the rapper Logic. He's just a white guy. Let's be real. I know Logic identifies as biracial. He says he's biracial. You look at his dad. His dad's mulatto. It's like Logic, the rapper. He's a white guy. Like nobody would ever question him and say he's a black guy. But because he wants the street cred, he does the hip hop music, the hip hop songs. He wants that credibility to be down with the blacks because it's a black dominated endeavor. So he wants to hold on to that whole biracial label. But it's like we're looking at him like, bro, you're just a white guy with some African admixture. But in America, I see that he's not. He's just a visible guy, a visible kind of quote unquote quadroon. But there's a lot of other guys and gals, okay, like a Mariah Carey, something like that, where it's like, look, they're more white than they are black. So it's like they're basically kind of, for all intents and purposes, more so white. I don't know. I'm just giving you guys my perspective on it, or this political thing. But these entertainers, they want to grift. They have the black audience they want to make money off of. You see that even on YouTube. On YouTube, you got biracials who want to get a black audience. So they bring in all the blacks and grift off the blacks to get their whatever. It's a business. You know, they want their money, their subscribers, their views. So they try to grift off blacks. Look at a guy, Angry Biracial. There's a channel, Angry Biracial. That's his channel name. But yet most of his followers, his subscribers, supporters are black. Black women specifically. And it's like, you know, that's the funny thing. It's like, it's just a grift, man. It's just a grift. You're going to grift off blacks. There's more numbers. Like, that's why people wonder why you have like a Zendaya, who's a biracial, clearly biracial woman, mulatta, who identifies as black. Well, it's like, well, look, she's in Hollywood. Paula Patton. They're in Hollywood. Like, they want to market themselves to a broader audience. They want blacks to watch their movies, to support their TV shows and all this stuff. So they want to identify. It kind of makes sense from a business standpoint. I'm just in a different position because I'm looking at the things for the long run politically. It's not just making a buck. Like, we need our own shit, our own protection. We need our own advocacy. Okay. Too many of these mulattoes feel like they don't have a place where they belong. And we have to change that. Let them know you belong here. You're protected here. This is for you. Okay. That's my intention with my social media. You sent me an email. Yeah, I think I saw it. Yeah, I'll double check. Yeah, you're talking about these coward ass mulattoes who are black identified. They want to try to sucker the rest of us to be foot soldiers for the communita. I despise seeing other mixed people bending the knee and tap dancing for these black supremacists. They're doing us no justice. They're your biggest opposition. The black identified mulattoes are your biggest opposition, because we can see the Bantus from a mile away, because a lot of these Bantus are going to dance around and pretend, oh, I'm mixed like you. I'm an MGM. I got, you know, 18% non-African, you know, heritage. So I'm mixed just like you. I belong here in this space. You'll have these Bantus come over here, try to pretend like they're just like you. But it's the mulattoes who bring them in, who open the door for them to jump in here and dance around your space. Okay. So yeah, it's easy to gatekeep. Okay. But it's the mulattoes that you know, who are black identified, who always open up the back door to bring in all the Bantus to destabilize your entire situation. Your main opposition is always going to be mulattoes when you do this type of content and material. Facts, period. Prove me wrong. Yeah, I'm not special. I tell people, look, I'm not the nicest guy. I'm not the smartest guy. Okay, I'm nobody special. I'm not special at all. I'm just not black. I don't identify as the blacks. I'm not a black. I'm not treated as a black in this country of the United States of America. I'm treated as a mixed guy, which in some cases can be kind of like a double fuck you, right? Because the blacks are going to hate on your ass because they're jealous, or they know you don't identify with them, so they look at you as a threat. And the whites are going to hate on you because a lot of whites, because they're going to look at you like they don't know where you stand, the mutability. And they know a lot of mulattoes historically in America, they identify with black. So they throw whites under the bus to serve blacks. So a lot of whites are going to hate on you. A lot of Hispanics, because they're competing with you. Okay. So it's an interesting situation. I'm not going to play the victim Olympics, but I'm being realistic about the situation. Okay. I'm not special. I'm just not black. I don't identify with them. They're not my people. I don't, you know, they're welcome to listen, tune in and join the conversation, but don't get it twisted. You're dealing with a different caliber of individual here. And all the black identified mulattoes, okay, they can kiss my ass too, right? Yeah, it's basically inevitable. It doesn't matter any major city you go to in this country, they're there. They just need to get access to this information. Once they get access to this information, they realize, oh, there's other people out here. There's a messenger. There's someone speaking their language. It's just a rap. It's a rap. It's only going to kind of spiral and continue to grow. Black men have kids with white women. When a kid is always supposed to have kids with someone black to fix their mistakes of bringing themselves out, that's the psychopathy of those people. It's like a Dr. Umar. He's like, oh, I know the black man made a mistake. That's what the pro-blacks would tell you. Oh, I know the black man made a mistake by getting a snow bunny. Dr. Umar calls it a snow bunny crisis. But then Dr. Umar, the rest of the pro-wax, the black supremacists, they're trying to convince these biracials, oh, well, you need to marry back into the black population. You need to absorb. They want to absorb us because they look at us as a threat. Whenever we gain traction, our numbers grow, we start to collectivize, they look at us as a threat in society. Because remember, all these blacks, they serve their white massa. They love whites. Doesn't matter what they say on social media, they all clock in, punch the time clock into their white masses corporation. They love whites, okay? And they're competing with mulattoes for white acceptance. So they're mad if we ever, when our numbers grow, they're going to have to compete with us in the workforce, the job market, for social acceptability. So they definitely don't like you. So guys like these pro-wacks, like Dr. Umar, their goal is to neutralize you, to reabsorb you back into the black population. So yeah, you see the kind of sick, twisted pathology where it's like, Dr. Umar will say, oh, a black man, you made a mistake. You got a snow bunny. But now he wants the biracial offspring to fix the mistake of his quote unquote brother, his African brother. These people are fucking sick. My whole position is, look, we got to provide another option for these mulattoes to get away. Get away for your sanity, because they have a lot of failures and fuck ups that we don't want. It's not good enough for them then. So lazy, they're always asking us for favors, but they're not paying us. I have my Cash App across the screen and they don't pay me. That's the funny thing. It's like, look, they got to pay now. They got to pay. There's a price. Black Americans are sexually competitive. Most seem on level of an animal. You say sexually competitive. Yeah. Because especially for the men, the males, the Bantu males, their whole value, they rank themselves based on their body count, right? The number of mates they've had. And even it's so bad, it's so degenerate in some circles where it's like their badge of honor is having baby mamas. In some of the black male spaces, the ghetto ones, where that's literally one of their badge of honors, is having a baby mama. It's like a rite of passage to be a pookie and with some of these characters. But that's where it comes in with that sexual competition, right? Because like, it's not based off how much businesses they have, how much money they have. It's based off how many chicks they've laid down with, right? That's their metric of measuring their kind of status amongst the other males in the group. How many people do they plan to get pregnant? Yeah, well, they have a lot of these biracial women, not you, Val, but some other ones, where it's like their pathway to blackness is by having pookies, okay, bastard kids, having a black man's bastard kids. That's their way to prove their blackness. They can stay in debt and they can anchor themselves and give themselves legitimacy in blackness. We have already analyzed this. I've been knew this for a minute. I've already observed this. This is how they gain their access, membership access into blackness, by having black men's bastard kids. And so a lot of them voluntarily get pregnant and impregnated by this caliber of individual. And then they'll cry later. They'll cry feminism and how the men aren't protecting them. But for whatever reason, these same individuals spread their legs open for some random guy. You know, they're not married to the guy. They're, you know, illegitimate. So they let these random guys run up in them, but then they sit there and cry about not being protected. I mean, and people listen to some of these losers, which is sad, but they're black identified. You don't have biracial children around black women. They'll take out their feeling. Yeah, that's crazy. And you have firsthand knowledge in that, Val. I trust your input and insight. The amount of full black people I've heard claiming to be mixed, nobody says anything to them. They only call the actual mixed person self-hating for saying they're mixed. These people are very stupid. You make a valid point. Let me give you the horn for that, because you know, you're right on the money with that. You're absolutely right. And they act like it's normal. You see somebody who's black as fuck and they'll use the term black passing. You're black passing because you're black. You're not mixed passing. You don't look like me or Val or somebody else. You look like a black. You're just black. You have admixture. But you'll have people who they'll be like, oh, I'm mixed, or I have some native blood, or I have European blood. You know, my grandma was mulatto or whatever. They'll make all these claims without any providing any evidence. And it's like nobody says anything. They just play along with them. And I've done it too. We play along because we know, don't entertain these people. You're going to waste your time. But a lot of people, they don't even entertain them. They just, I mean, play along. It's like, okay, brush it off. But you're absolutely right. They only claim the actual mixed people like me and you as being self-hating because we say we're mixed. But you have a full black person who's 85, whatever, 80 plus percent black, dark skinned Bantu. They won't say that person's self-hating for claiming their little 20% less than that European admixture. Not even a griff. You know, a griff is like 25, 30%. A lot of these cats, they're not even cutting the line for a griff. They're just blacks with admixture. It's like, fucking A. And it's the biracials who entertain them because they need simp enforcers. They need the numbers. They need to kind of form their little, you know, feminist Voltron, get their little simp enforcers that are literally going to get smacked down fucking with me, to be honest with you. But yeah, they only claim us as being self-hating for claiming we're mixed, right? Yeah, they're not the smartest group, right? We understand that. True that, Val, right? These blacks will be as dark as night and claim they're mixed. Yeah, they'll be blacker than Shaquille O'Neal, blacker than the fucking Black Panther talking about they're mixed. And then they bring somebody else's fake DNA results to say, look, see, I got admixture. I'm not 100% black. I'm like 18% non-black. I'm like, I don't give a fuck what you are, homie. You're not mulatto. I'm not dealing with you. Go over there with the baby mamas and shut the hell up. Just don't put my name in your mouth, okay? Val puts here, those weird Black Knight cartoons on Angry Biracial's channel are funny because they're so bad. Yeah, that guy's just making money off black people. That's his hustle. I knew a mixed dude who was black identified and had 8 baby mamas. Yeah, they take on the same degenerate culture as the black pookies, right? Exactly, Val. These black peoples can claim to be natives, Moors, Egyptians, but we can't claim to be mixed. Fuck out of here. Yeah, they have a whole basically psyop going on. And the thing is, the biracials entertain them. You should laugh at them. You should laugh at them. Use them for content. They're going to call you racist, a white supremacist. That's all they got. And everybody, and they're being exposed daily because now these other groups like Asians, you have the page Asia, Asian Dawn. A lot of these black supremacists and black racists, they're getting exposed daily all over social media. So it's like, I don't know why a lot of these mixed people are punks and cowards that don't understand. It doesn't matter what they call you. They're 10 times worse. Look at their behavior. Just judge them by their behavior. Get your receipts, okay? Document it and show the public. They can say whatever the hell they want that I use, because what they say about me is that I say mean things. I said a mean word. Like, that's the worst thing I could do is you say a mean word. But I'm like, these people are literally, if you're a biracial woman, they're trying to cut your hair because they're jealous of your beautiful biracial hair. If you're a biracial guy, they're trying to cut your face because they say, oh, you're a pretty light-skinned guy, pretty biracial. They want to cut, like, they're literally trying to damage you, ruin your reputation, tarnish your sexual marketplace value. They're competing with you. Everybody sees the savagery with a lot of them, but how many are calling it out? Especially these mulattoes, not that many. Guess what? I got to be the bad guy, which is okay. But these punk ass, weak ass, fucking biracials get in my way. I'm not really, you know, not really too pleasant about them. Okay. Let me get back into this. Finish this off, guys, before I close things out. Shout out to all you guys in the chat, your comments. I appreciate your guys' engagement. Definitely keeps me motivated to keep hopping up back up here. So cheers to you guys. Where I left off, I think it was very important that Barack Obama identified as a black man while acknowledging his white family, because so many white people tried to claim him as being not black, but half white, probably forcing as many of their ancestors to sit up in their graves for allowing this uppity Negro to ascend to the presidency. It's uppity mulatto, not a Negro. His wife is Negro. His wife is black. Barack Obama is biracial. Mulatto, right? Even his wife called him biracial. We got the public. We got the receipts of that. So, yeah, that's forever. Never had I seen so many white people clamoring to take somebody's blackness from them when they spent so many years giving out blackness like Oprah gives out cars. Oh, shit. Excuse me. Here we go. To some people, Marco is a black woman, plain and simple. To others, she's a biracial woman. To me, you can be both, because he's member black identified. So they use the term black biracial. To others, she can't. It looks like she appreciates both sides of herself and doesn't want to choose for career and personal reasons. But she's also not running from being black, which is what black folks hate more than anything in discussions like this. Remember, he speaks for black people. He doesn't say anything about what white people feel or what white people think, even though he has a white mom. He's a mulatto. He's not balanced. He's black identified. He's only taken the perspective of black people. You notice that throughout this article. He's like, which is what black folks hate more than anything. Like, he's literally the magical mulatto, the mulatto voice speaking for black people. And of course, black people prop him up because he's their tool. They can use him, this mulatto, to try to encourage other mulattoes to identify as black, to be mules and subordinates. But like I said, these are older people. I'm telling you, the younger people, they're not going for it. They realize they have other options here. So I think all of us who are mixed and who struggle with the identity politics of it all need to accept that, because our complicated history, the debate will never cease. It's very important to realize that you don't have to reject one thing to accept another. Walking and chewing gum is a thing. That goes for mixed folks and non-mixed people. Everybody hates being defined by who don't share their history or reality. That's an interesting kind of conclusion here. Everybody hates being defined by people who don't share their history or reality. I agree with that statement. But we all do it in so many other ways. We are a labeled-centric culture that is not likely to change soon. Be you, but don't forget that others are looking too. He's like, don't forget, they still gonna see what's black. That's like the main argument. that the Blackistan gaslighters will tell you, oh, they just gonna see you as black. You just gonna be a black to them. So you could say you biracial all you want. It doesn't matter. When the police pulls you over, they gonna see you black. Other people are looking. The others are looking. Don't forget that. You better realize you black. Sit your black ass down. Kiss my black butt. And let me be the one to tell you you mix and you ain't black. Because I want to have power over you. Because my white massa likes you more than me. Because you more white than me. And I don't like you biracials because you more white than me. So you need to sit your ass down. So let me punk. You see, that we all see the game. You can laugh and ha ha ha. We all see the game. Okay. It's these mulattoes, these black identified mulattoes with their academic jargon who want to trick us and fool us to serve these blacks and these Bantus. It's not happening, baby. Okay. We're in 2024. This article was wrote 2017. Moving forward, it's not happening. These mulattoes realize they have another option. They have another choice. They're going to embrace it. They're going to build upon it. It's not stopping. And if you largely benefit from proximity to blackness, which a lot of people do, remember how much of an a-hole you look when folks are talking about race and you make sure to point out that you are not black. Don't be an a-hole, basically. Me, my black is beautiful. My mother is white. I am not. Yeah, he's not balanced. He's black identified, biracial, which is very typical. But I wanted to share the article with you guys, my audience, because I know a lot of you guys, it will resonate with you, especially my commentary, my kind of off the cusp, assertive commentary. A lot of you will digest it, you know, effectively. I think that's why you guys tune into me. A lot of people who support me, got a lot of haters too, which is fine as long as they're listening. But yeah, let's get what we got here. GP in the house says, hey, MV, glad I caught live. Keep bearing the drum, broski. She's attempted. We are talking to NBA. Were we taking over the NBA? I think you shared a link. Let me see what you got here. See if I can click the link. I got to do it from the chat somewhere else. And Instagram, DC. Shout out to you, DC. One of my... it says I can't even open up the link. Oh, yeah, because I'm blocked. You shared a link from Biracial Lounge. The Biracial Lounge, I believe that's a Magic Mulata and Jake Bell's little click. So they blocked me on all their socials. So, yeah, the Biracial Lounge is little Magic Mulata's little side project she has, basically trying to steal all my shit and rebrand it. He said with Blake Griffin, biracialness, his white mom. Yeah, that's Jake Bell and Magic Mulata. They basically watch and copy everything I do, steal my shit. And they put it on their Biracial Lounge page, but they basically blocked me everywhere, Instagram, TikTok. So I'm not surprised. They're all a bunch of schemers over there. Yeah. Wouldn't Chris Brown and some of T.I.'s kids consider grips? I don't know too much about that. Somebody else could get into specifics, but I don't follow either of them. I can attest to that. When I was still in high school, the blacks would be pissed off when I said I was mixed mulatto. They tried so hard to claim I'm black. Yeah, it's because they want the right of refusal. They want to be the ones to tell you you're not black. They don't want you to exercise that power. They don't want you to look them in the eye and be like, I'm not like you. I'm not black. I'm not dark skin or whatever, light skin. I'm not a black. I'm mixed. I'm mulatto. They don't want you to have that power. They want to be the ones to be able to outgroup you. They get really irritated and frustrated and angered when you take that power away from them. They've had kind of that, you know, that gatekeeping power for far too long. I'm just trying to encourage these mulattoes to start embracing ourselves and exercising that. Take the power back, basically. Have you seen the video of Isaiah Hartingston? He's a white NBA player identifying as black because he has a biracial dad. He shows how stupid a one-drop rule is. Yeah, so you'd be like what they call, like I said, like a logic, what they call a quadroon, which people don't really use that term. You know, a lot of people don't use the term mulatto. They don't like it, but it's the best term we have currently. I like it because our history is tied to it, and it's very easy to identify that and pull up the receipts based on that. And my arguments still stand strong. But yeah, I'm not surprised. I dropped a link if you guys want to jump up here. Anybody wants to kind of challenge or critique or just chop it up or anything, just stick around for a few more minutes and then I'm going to close things out. You are dropping gems. You put here exactly what it is. They want to be the ones telling us you're not black. Yeah, because they call the right of refusal. They want to exercise power over you. Because you notice that whenever you tell them you're not black, all of a sudden they want to tell you, oh, you're still black. According to the one drop rule, the white man, you're black. You're the seed of your father. You have a black dad. You're black. You're the seed of your father. Oh, it doesn't matter if you claim biracial. The one drop rule. When the police pulls you over, you black, right? Or they'll say, what does your birth certificate say? They will argue you up and down, especially I see on TikTok. They will argue you and fight with you if you say you're not black. Once you go around saying you're black, they're all going to run up in their comments. You're not black. You're biracial. You're not the same, right? This is the game they play with you because they're powerless people. And they look at the mulattoes' predicament and situation, and they want to exploit it. They want to look, use the mulatto as a utilitarian class. They know these mulattoes are basically, a lot of them are tribeless and they are raceless. Honestly, a lot of these mulattoes, so they know that. So they're exploiting the predicament of a lot of these mulattoes, and a lot of the mulattoes entertain them, fall for it. But a guy like me, they know it's kind of hard to budge. So their best option is to get one of their punk ass black identified biracials to try to challenge me. That's what typically happens. When I notice a lot of these biracials who challenge me, they always got some black or some Bantu whispering in their ear behind the scenes. So the biracial is going to be a mule fighting the black battle, trying to challenge me for some Bantu. It's typically what happens I've seen so far. But yeah, guys, I've been here for a minute. Appreciate you guys. You know, in the chat, your engagement. Love seeing you guys here. You, if you're here, I mean, this is where you belong. This is a place for you. And my whole intention with my streams, with my videos, my commentary, I want to be as consistent as I possibly can, is I want to create a home for mulattoes. I want to be a hub, a think tank, that basically a headquarters where these mulattoes can come and brainstorm, share and exchange notes. Have this place of belonging. This is for you. This is a community service for you. I find great, you know, comfort and amusement and excitement, if I can say that, to provide for you guys. This is literally what I feel like I'm destined to do at this stage in my life, is to give you guys a space where you can belong and just simply exist. Okay. So yeah, I'm going to kind of close things out right now. And yeah, I'm going to catch you guys on the next one. So with that, love you guys. See you next time. Sayonara.